Good afternoon. Thanks again for coming to CSIS on this balmy Wednesday afternoon in November, December. You know, it's given me a lot of pleasure to be here today and to introduce Bill Brock, who's going to kick us off. But before I do, I really want to thank the Alcoa Foundation for its contribution to what has been a pretty interesting series of events that we've held here on competitiveness and manufacturing. Today we're going to be talking a little bit about industrial policies in some other key countries that are emerging as potential competitors, or if one likes to think of them that way. But the person who is going to moderate and chair the session is really doesn't need a whole lot of introduction. Bill Brock has been a senator, a USTR, Secretary of Labor, and we're most proud of the fact that he's here at CSIS on an increasing basis and chairs our International Policy Roundtable. So let me introduce to you to Bill Brock. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for coming. Just for the record, we've been having, this is the third of this particular series that Alcoa was kind enough to support at the beginning. And what we've been looking at, for those of you that have not been able to do the earlier two sessions, is basically the global economy, the context that establishes for the United States and for those partners that we have around the world. And particularly, we've been looking at the question of how does this different world, fundamentally different world, how does it change the way we look at the conduct and composition of both domestic and international economic policy? It's you got to be my age to realize just how fast the world has changed and how much it's changed. I try to tease my children or college students when I'm talking by asking the question, you know, how long has the internet been around? And people say 20, 30 years. Most of them, it's been around longer than they have. And when you say, well, it's only 15 years old in terms of its application or availability for the people of this country, it's really hard to understand the transformation that has brought. And it's very difficult when you look at this country and its a political makeup, and I'm not talking about the dysfunctional nature of this town in the last few years, but just in terms of the way we compose and agree upon our relations with other countries, our domestic policies. There are a lot of people who argue that it's really tough for a system like ours to be as able to adapt to this changing world as some of our competitors are. And we began by looking, and I guess, John, in the first session we had about how we address everything from currency issues to the potential for trade protectionism. Could we, as a country, afford not to engage in some of the practices that some of our competitors engage in? And if we could, how would we do it? Or if we couldn't, what would be the alternative? Should we address changes in policy areas that would give us more flexible tools to adapt? The last session we had, we looked at defense and the importance of the defense base in this country, which is continuing and strong, and its importance to manufacturing writ large in this country. So today we're moving to four specific countries that which can give us some examples of what others are doing, and on the basis of that, think about what that implies for us. The questions I'm sure you've seen in your agenda will begin with What is the competitive environment in these four countries, Brazil, China, Germany, and Russia? How has that evolved over the past decade or so? What are their policy approaches for stimulating a manufacturing? And how is their policymaking environment responding to perceived theirs or ours successes and failures? So it's an adequate agenda for an afternoon's conversation. And we've got some really wonderfully able people that I will give you a very brief mention of their credentials, which are extensive. Otherwise, we could spend the whole meeting talking about what they've done. But let me begin by Rick Burt, who was former ambassador to Germany, managing director of McLarty Associates. He came to McKinsey before McLarty after successfully concluding a nuclear arms treaty as the chief negotiator in the strategic arms reduction talks with the former Soviet Union. Prior to that, of course, he was the U.S. ambassador to the Federal Republic of Germany in the late 80s. And Charles Freeman, most of you would be thoroughly familiar with Charles. He holds the Freeman Chair in China Studies here at CSIS. He concentrates on the political economy of China and other parts of East Asia and U.S.-China relations, particularly trade and economic. Andrew Kitchens just came in. Welcome. Yeah, we were dragging him from one meeting to the next. You're good to come. He's a senior fellow and director of the CSIS Russia and Eurasia program. He's an internationally renowned expert on Russian foreign and domestic policies. He publishes widely books, papers, and a number of contributions to the debate and understanding of Russia. Kelly Meeman Hawk, former 10 years, Kelly has led the Brazilian Southern Core and Trade Practices of McLarty Associates. She previously worked at the Office of the U.S. Trade Representative, my old stomping ground, as director for Brazil and the Southern Cone, where she had primary responsibility for Brazil, Argentina, Chile, Paraguay, and Uruguay. She leads the Trade Facilitation Task Force of the U.S.-Brazil Business Council. So we have an awful lot of talent, and what I'll ask them to do, each in turn, to give you 5, 10, 15 minutes, whatever they're comfortable with, to sketch out each of the countries that they're going to present, and then we will open the conversation to all of us for questions, expressions of concern and suggestions, if I might. So, Kelly, if I can begin with you, we'll kick it off.
Great. Thank you so much, Bill. And I've got a PowerPoint. I'm not sure how that'll come up.
Flicker someplace?
Yeah. There we go. Are you my clicker?
No, I can click it for you.
No, I'll click it. This one?
Yep.
Got it. Great. Thanks. Super. Well, thank you for the opportunity to be here today with such a distinguished panel at CSIS and to address you all a bit on Brazil's perspective on industrial policy. Thought I'd just go through a PowerPoint presentation quickly. Brazil really comes at industrial policy not as a you know, new innovation. This is something that is really in Brazilian DNA. If you look, it's a little bit small up there, but during the time of the military regime in Brazil, which also ended not that long ago, back in 85, and look at the 70s when the Brazilian so-called economic miracle took place, a lot of that was due to industrial planning and industrial policy. Of course, that was back in kind of the bad old days, if you will, of import substitution industrialization, the Raul Prebisch theory, and not the most sustainable way to industrialize. But layer that on top of in the pre-military regime days, the fact that there was already this penchant towards developing rather large state-owned industries and state-owned enterprises, many of which during the privatization period we look at today, and those are the multi-Brasis, these new multinational Brazilian companies that have become real powerhouses. Many of them have roots back in this period both pre-military period and ISI period of very intense, very planned industrial policy. Then, you know, obviously the 80s, everything kind of froze for a bit during that lost decade of both debt crisis and hyperinflation. And then in the 90s, things really turned a bit. You had Brazil opening itself up, in many cases unilaterally, through tariff reductions, privatizing many of those previously state-held SOEs, starting to engage in trade agreements, developing the Mercosur Agreement, both for their own interests and also to some extent as a response to NAFTA. And that opening really did take an economy which had been extremely, extremely protected and with just an abysmally low percentage of GDP relying on trade, and did force in a number of those industries an increased competitiveness. They still were, you know, from a free trader's perspective, quite protected. But in comparing it to, you know, those 1970s days of when industrial policy originated, this really was a new innovation for Brazil. And so how did they leverage that more outward-looking orientation then? I mean, really, the game changer in Brazil, as many of you I'm sure know, was having a stable currency and nipping in the bud hyperinflation, which had plagued them for decades. The Real Plan came into play in July of 94, and that really did allow Brazilians for the first time, because of the elimination or at least controlling, well, elimination of hyperinflation and controlling of inflation, plan their consumption to be more outward looking, even more so in their orientation. You saw more interlocking supply chains between the United States and Europe. And then, you know, you really did, and this is obviously more recent, and a big part of Brazil's boom economically here over the last 10 years has been the emergence of China, Asian, and Middle Eastern markets as a home for Brazilian products, primarily still a lot of basic goods, inputs, agricultural products, et cetera. But a real diversification away from what, again, historically used to be an industrial policy driven towards really producing for the Brazilian market and starting to think about, okay, how do we take these policies and look at how we can conquer other markets as well. And I might be giving a little bit too much credit to Minister Furlan, who was Lula's first commerce minister, but I really don't think so. I mean, he historically ran what's one of the largest poultry interests in Brazil, Sadia, and really came to the position of commerce minister looking at it as, you know, a sales guy. You know, he had spent his entire career going around the world selling chicken to people from, you know, countries throughout the globe. And he really attacked his job as commerce minister with that same perspective, but looking cross-sectorally across the Brazilian economy and thinking, okay, what can we do to outreach better to other markets and really really sell better and connect better with other markets. Another piece I put down there, APEX, ABDI, and a more aggressive BNDS. APEX and ABDI are two entities that developed under really the leadership. I would say they a couple of them originated under the previous administration, but were really deepened under President Lula and under Furlan. And those entities were designed to really help to foment and grow certain sectors of the Brazilian economy, be it you know, cosmetics, aerospace, telecommunications, et cetera. Certain sectors were identified, and those agencies were designed to really help to think, how can we make these sectors more competitive? And also BNDES, that's the Brazilian Development Bank, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later, but they became increasingly aggressive as well. So you had these really pro-growth policies that came with the opening of the Brazilian economy, the diversification of their export markets, and, you know, all of that kind of running gangbusters. And you know, that included the factors that I've got here on the first point. You had Brazil really investing in growing their middle class. You've got the conditional cash transfer programs that have been, much has been made of them, and with a lot of reason. The Bolsa Família program that provides, as long as you are, you know, sending your kids to school, getting them vaccinated, et cetera, provides a certain BOLSA scholarship, bunch of money for your family to be able to sustain themselves. You had already had pre-crisis an increasing reliance on state-owned banks to keep credit flowing. You already had an increasing infrastructure focus by the Brazilian government through the PAC, which is the Program for Accelerated Growth, which, again, even pre-crisis had been announced to try to address some of the infrastructure shortcomings, because as Brazil has started to grow increasingly quickly over the last decade, it's been increasingly clear how much they really do need to focus on port, transportation, et cetera, infrastructure, and the PAC was designed to try to address that. You already had industrial policy, again, as I'd mentioned before, focusing on three certain key sectors through what they call the PDP, which, again, is a policy that identifies 10 different sectors and says, all right, these are the sectors that we are going to focus on through giving tax benefits to export incentives, et cetera, and trying to make those really some of the core cornerstones of our economy going forward. You also had R&D. I mean, we're talking here about manufacturing, but I think it's important to also highlight that as part of the Brazilian industrial policy, they did not forget about R&D software. There is an incredible amount of money that's being set aside through BNDES and other sources to try to incent at this time increased software development within Brazil, and that's a sector that actually has been doing really, really growing in an impressive way. You've got Google with an R&D center in the state of Minas Gerais. You've got, over the last year, both GE and IBM announced new R&D centers in Brazil. So this is truly bearing fruit. And then tax incentives, as I mentioned. There's a tax in Brazil called the IPI, which is up there, which is developed and designed to really try to incent local production. That's localizing production is an incredibly large focus of a lot of the Brazilian industrial policy, be it through the Development Bank. In order to get funding from the Development Bank that I mentioned before, you have to have at least 60% local content, not unlike some of the stipulations that we have here with our own Exim. But relevant to note, IPI, if you're not producing locally, if you're importing a product that is produced locally, then you'll have this extra IPI tax layered on top of what you're already, the other multitudinous taxes that you're already paying in Brazil, which is one of the challenges in Brazil is the complex tax code. But they do use that complex tax code in a lot of different situations to try to incent certain industries and promote their industrial policy. So that was really the state of play pre-crisis. And then you've got all those pro-growth policies. They hit the financial crisis. What does that do? That really gives Brazil an opportunity to take advantage of the fact that they had, at the time the crisis hit, they had about $200 billion in reserves. In a very positive situation in that they had that chunk of money. They had really the policy space and the economic space to be able to invest. And this gives you a little bit of an idea here how they invested that stimulus money. About $10 billion of it went just to try to support the state-owned banks, be it BNDES, Banco do Brasil, Caixa Econômica Federal, in being sure that they were able to keep credit flowing. That IPI that I mentioned before, in many industries, be it construction, autos, et cetera, where the government deemed that it was important to the Brazilian economy to kind of keep consumption flowing, keep construction going, they put in place tax exemptions of the IPI and others to try to keep that moving forward. Continued the sectoral targets that I had mentioned before, but with a special focus on these that I have here, banking, auto, the auto industry, housing, construction, and agriculture. And then again, and particularly because over this time frame that we're discussing, you had the awarding of both the World Cup for 2014 and the Olympics for 2016 to Brazil. So you had an even more intense pressure to focus on the infrastructure question. So you look at all of the ways that they channeled the money, either through state PACs programs, which is that Program for Accelerated Growth, the infrastructure program, federal financing through BNDES. Petrobras is kind of an animal of it in and of itself, especially post pre-salt fines, where they are investing incredibly in various industrial projects to get that oil out of the ground. So you've got a lot of money flowing and a lot of kind of renewed focus as far as having a state-led role in being sure that a lot of these industrial projects and policies were being well-funded. So you look at this, you know, what are the questions going forward? I mean, addressing the question of the panel here, useful model or sustainable success. I think that there are a lot of things here that do show that there are elements of what Brazil has done that do provide useful points to model off of. I've highlighted here, though, some of the questions that I think we need to address going forward to really, I don't think you can call the Brazil case writ large a useful model until you address some of these questions that I've got here. And the number one structural roadblock, at least for me, is education. It's the fact that, you know, you can put all the tax incentives that you want on growing R&D and software industries, et cetera. You've got to have those engineers to staff those places. And so this is something that has been kind of the reform of always, the reform that's always been needed to be done in Brazil. Hopefully it'll be something that incoming President Rousseff can address. Federal spending. A lot of those programs that I've highlighted thus far in the presentation, it's a lot of government spending on the part of Brazil. And it does create an inflationary threat, which in the Brazilian psyche is a big deal, given the history of hyperinflation. I've got 10% versus 5%. If you look at what they're projecting for growth of government spending, growth of the federal budget next year, it's a 10% growth rate. Compare that to 5% inflation rate. Thank you. That's pledged for next year, and you can see that this is going to continue to be an issue, and the overly strong real and their ability to therefore continue to grow exports to some of these diversified markets that they've opened up is going to be challenged by the overly strong real. And as much as you heard around the G20 meetings, Minister Mantega and others, the finance minister of Brazil and others talking about this challenge of, you know, guerra cambial, you know, the currency war, at the end of the day, Brazil is going to have to address this issue of the level of public sector spending in order to, just within their own house, address the issue of the overvalued real and the impact that that has on their industrial sectors and their export possibilities. Another question that a lot of analysts are asking right now is there an over-reliance on the state-owned banks? Is this somehow going to have a lasting impact on the ability to finance long-term projects? You see, you know, the extent to which BNDES, the development bank, has been capitalized just over the last 10 years. It used to be $9 billion back in 2000. Now it's about $25 billion. The FDI and export diversification factor, this is a positive. Will that continue? You know, China now this year is $20 billion is what they're looking to invest in Brazil. And that's, you know, a really groundbreaking number for them. They've never been that high of levels before. Infrastructure projects, we talked about that before. Where will that money go? Will it be spent, you know, whenever you've got that much money flowing, that many projects going, are you spending intelligently? And that's a question that a lot of people are watching right now. And then the final point that I'll make that I see as just a overall risk in industrial policy, not just in Brazil, but I would say also here in the United States, is this trending towards binational policies. Obviously, we had our Buy America, and in a sense that did kind of open the door to other countries pursuing similar policies. The Brazilians have a binational policy. It was done by presidential decree and just passed by their Congress last week, or approved by their Congress last week, that does impose a number of government procurement benefits on locally produced products and services. I guess the question for me is, where does that trend continue? I mean, you know, right now we've got some of the larger markets, U.S., Brazil, that have put in these binational policies. But when you've got your largest export market for Brazil being Argentina, what if Argentina, you know, in January decides to do a Buy Argentina bill? Where does this end? And what impact does that have on Brazilian industries? So I think I'll leave it there and leave anything else to the Q&A. Thank you.
Charles?
Thank you. I'm not nearly as organized as Kelly, so don't have a PowerPoint. So I'm just going to tell a story. I think that the questions that are raised at the outset here, and even in the title, looking at Brazil, China, Germany, and Russia's industrial policy, useful models, sustainable success, I think that's a very interesting question applied to China, because I'm not sure we know what the China model is, and I'm not sure that we know whether the current success is was sustainable in China if China decides that its model is something that then perhaps it's not. And clearly, I mean, right now, particularly in the wake of the global financial crisis, China is feeling extremely good about itself. It had a very targeted, fairly well-designed stimulus package that actually was stimulus and not merely transfer payments internally, actually was directed at infrastructure and other areas that really will generate economic activity for some time. So fairly successful model of a stimulus package in the middle of a crisis. But what happened as a result of the crisis and China's sense of its relative rise respective to the United States was a perception that the Washington consensus, which even if China never really embraced that consensus, China always held out the Washington consensus as sort of an ideal model, what you'd really do if you wanted to have an economy that was clicking on all cylinders, if you had the political elbow room to do it. In the wake of the crisis, the Washington consensus in China was completely discredited, and people actually started talking about something that might be a Beijing consensus or at least a China model, or maybe more correctly, a China approach to things. And if you talk to Chinese scholars or officials about the China approach or the China model, you get a variety of different answers about what that is. And not a lot of people can identify it with any specificity. But what people will tell you generally is that a cornerstone of the China model is state-directed capitalism, i.e. the model of that was used in the stimulus package during the recent crisis, i.e. the state directing capitalism to achieve industrial policy ends. And that's, you know, that's an interesting question, whether that truly is the China model. Really, for 30-plus years, China has generated double-digit growth, and I'm not sure that that was a result of state-directed capitalism. Indeed, if you look at state-directed activities, particularly through the state-owned enterprises for the past 20 years or so have consumed 70% of the resources and only produced about 30% of the output, which is, you know, the precise reverse for the private sector or the non-state sector in China. So the question is whether state-directed capitalism, as it goes through the state sector, is really what is driving new growth in China. Certainly, there are a lot of people in China who believe it is. And certainly, really, going back to the end of 2001, when China first joined the WTO, there are a lot of people in China who have been active in producing industrial policies designed to stimulate the economy in a wide range of sectors. And anybody who spends any time with the Chamber of Commerce or the U.S.-China Business Council or anyone who spends any time in boardrooms that have anything to do with China is quite familiar with the gnashing of teeth and wringing of hands as a result of some of these industrial policies. And they run the gamut, again, from direct stimulus of Chinese industry in ways that discriminate against foreign business interests in China, anti-competition policies, which are designed to reduce monopolistic powers, in quotes, of foreign actors in the marketplace, the use of technical standards that are designed to stimulate either Chinese enterprises that produce these standards uniquely or force foreign companies to produce in China according to these standards. You know, direct subsidies of research and development, again, in the name of producing Chinese innovation that grows domestic Chinese companies that can compete on the global stage in technology circles and the like, and procurement policies that are designed, again, to largely stimulate higher technology, higher value-added Chinese production. One can certainly point to the if one chooses, to the exchange rate policy as a industrial policy. It certainly has a primary effect, if not intent, and I think the intent is there as well, to benefit Chinese exporters and continue to preserve some margin for those exporters in international trade that allows them to be competitive, not necessarily, with all deference to people like Fred Bergston, with U.S. producers, but certainly other exporters from Asia and possibly from Latin America and increasingly from Africa, at least some point down the road. And finally, one can also, if one chooses, and I think there's something there, call lax enforcement of intellectual property rights in China a policy designed to at least stimulate Chinese production through the use of property that is not theirs. One can say that perhaps this is not a coherent policy from the top, that it is a policy by effect rather than intent, but it certainly, the lax enforcement of intellectual property rights in China has a direct impact on the competitive abilities of Western firms in China and arguably throughout the world, and almost certainly should be a primary concern for those of us that still believe that United States technology and innovation is a primary United States competitive advantage. All of this said, if you look at all of these industrial policies to date, it's very hard to find a lot of success. Even though, there's a lot of gnashing of teeth and wringing of hands by foreign firms in the marketplace that say it's very difficult to compete with some of these firms that are getting benefits from the Chinese government in the form of subsidies or other policies that stimulate their advantage, it's hard to find a whole lot of successes in there. You can certainly point to some, but even those where there is clear production successes or export successes, like in solar panels and the like, it's hard to find a whole lot of profit there. So again, if your goal is to produce companies which can undersell others in globally, China's having some success at that. It's hard to find, though, a sustainable business model when you are losing money on the order that some of these companies are. I want to give an example of an industrial policy specifically in China, its impact on the marketplace, and some of the challenges that it presents, not only for foreign competitors in that market, but also for Chinese competitors. The Chinese government, for reasons good and just, and also in order to stimulate domestic Chinese production of green technology, declared that they wanted a certain percentage of wind energy as part of the overall energy mix in China. Overnight, you had, whereas the day before you had this announcement, you had, I think, three or four Chinese wind turbine producers, some of which were okay. All of a sudden, anybody that had ever produced a gearbox or something that looked like that could rotate or anything that could be put on a pole was a wind turbine producer in China. So today you have something like 80 wind turbine producers in China. This is not a sustainable model. This is not a market, or even the global market, can't sustain 80 wind turbine producers. Yet, as a result of this process, 80 were created. Now, a company that goes into that marketplace, and there are many Western companies that go in because of concerns about intellectual property, they go into that marketplace and they say, okay, we don't want to sell tomorrow's technology, we don't want to sell today's technology today in China. We would prefer to sell yesterday's technology because we have a better sense that our current technology will be preserved. So they go into the marketplace and they say, okay, we want to sell an 850 megawatt turbine in this market. Well, the Chinese customer knows that in Europe or the United States, the same company is selling a 1.5 gigawatt turbine, and so they want that one. I mean, they want the best, they want the finest, and they have the ability to pay for it. Well, no one from the foreign companies will sell that to them, so the Chinese companies say, we can build a bigger turbine, and they produce it. And so they sell a 1.5 gigawatt turbine in the marketplace. It's not good. Chances of failure are significant, but it's a big turbine. And that's what our companies, in many cases, are competing with. So that the impact, because of the initial industrial policy, is you get a lot of producers who can't produce on any profit margin at all, and who are certainly going to undersell global competition because it's because the competitive environment is so shrill. You've got substandard quality being produced in the marketplace by groups that really don't have the technology or the management to produce according to global scale. Is this a sustainable model? I'm not sure. Out of these 80 producers in China, are three or four or five or six going to be successful and emerge? One would think at a certain point that the Chinese would consolidate the overcapacity, the Chinese government would consolidate the overcapacity and bring it down to six or five or six companies. But the problem is, because of local protectionism in China, because provinces and municipalities all have their favorite companies, it's very difficult for Beijing to effectively quash the goals of these local governments to preserve their own, not just national champion, but provincial champion in wind turbine production. And so it's very difficult to consolidate that production. Now, what will happen long term? Well, you know, the local governments may continue to subsidize and support these companies, but they're all going to drift along. And I'm not certain that that is a sustainable business model. Ultimately, I think the lesson that the Chinese have learned from the financial crisis, that state-directed capitalism is the Chinese model of success, is completely the reverse. The Chinese model, and the one that has been so successful for so long, has been an intense focus on reforming to allow the market to play the primary role in Chinese policy, getting out of the way of the average Chinese citizens, and particularly in the private sector, to produce a products that make his or her life better and his or her child's life better, has been the primary generator of success in China for the past 30 years. Now, there are challenges with unchecked, unregulated market reform, certainly. And you can point to any number of disparities and dislocations in the Chinese marketplace, whether it's environmental challenges, whether it's income disparity, whether it's regional and rural-urban income disparities or development disparities. But it's very hard to argue that the reverse is the better option. I mean, frankly, industrial policies are what drove China from a relatively preferential place in the global economy in the early 1950s down to less than 1 percentage point of global GDP by 1978, when they had to give up and essentially allow the market to take hold. So I'm considerably worried, frankly, and if I were in Beijing and I was a Chinese leader, thank heavens I'm not, because their problems are certainly greater than any of ours. I would be very nervous about the current approach to industrial policy making in China, and the sense of hubris, maybe too strong, but certainly pride in the notion of state-directed capitalism as the primary model for Chinese growth for going into the future. Thank you.
Okay. Rick Burt.
Thank you, Bill. I guess I should begin by saying, when I was initially invited to appear on this panel, I thought that somebody had gotten something very wrong. Because what we have here are three of the four BRIC countries, and then you have Germany. And the Germans, of course, would be the last to consider themselves an emerging market. And they certainly don't fit that category. They're probably best thought of as a mature market. But given the experience, the German experience, economic experience of the last 12 months, while they may not be an emerging market, I think you can consider them a renaissance market. And I want to just demonstrate that by initially throwing out a few numbers. Well, 3 percentages and 1 fraction. 5%. Which is their estimated growth in GDP this year, 15%, which is their estimated growth of exports this year, 6%, which is their unemployment rate, and the fraction is 1/3, which is the German share of the overall GDP of the European Union as a whole. The one thing the economic crisis, I think, has underscored very dramatically, and you can tell that simply by reading the headlines from day to day focused on the euro crisis, is that they have emerged as the economic powerhouse of Europe. Now, it probably, given the nature of their economy and their maturity, it probably doesn't make much sense to compare and contrast the German model, if you want to call it a model, with Russia, China, Brazil, or India. So to the extent I'm going to be making comparisons and contrasts, it's going to be with the United States this afternoon, because I think there are some interesting ones. But to begin with, I think it's important to understand that the German economy and its approach to industry is really focused by, I think, two critical historical experiences of the 20th century. The first, of course, is the great inflation of the Weimar period in the 1920s that has burned deep into the consciousness of every German, not only because of its ruinous impact on the German economy and the destruction of the then German middle class, but I think the widely held view in Germany that it paved the way for the Third Reich and Adolf Hitler to come to power in the early 1930s. The second important shared historical memory is the immediate post-war period, when the Germans not only faced the daunting task of reconstruction, but what we often forget is the very real peril of communism. And by this, I don't mean the Soviet military threat, but the widely perceived threat that far left politics was going to dominate the German political scene. And that produced in the course of the 1950s, the middle of the 50s to the late 50s, the notion or the concept of what the Germans call their social market economy. The notion that Germany's economy needed to be driven by market forces, it needed to be driven by the private sector, but there had to be an ethos of social cohesion to defend that system from the excesses from the left. And I think both of those, if you want to understand the success of the German economy today, you need to understand those two shared experiences. A deep fear of inflation, of deficit spending, of stimulus on the one hand, and on the other, a very important shared ethos of social cohesion, of social equity. I mean, one example of that is the disparity, if you measure the disparity between the average salary of a German and the average salary of a German CEO, and compare that in the United States, the average American salary to the average salary of an American CEO, the German figure is about one-tenth that of an American CEO. The Germans will not socially tolerate the tremendous divergence of salaries and wages and wealth that has come to characterize the United States. That just doesn't work. It's not socially acceptable in Germany. Now, as far as industrial strategy is concerned, there really is no industrial policy per se. But that isn't to say there isn't what I guess would be better framed in Germany as an industrial consensus. First, the first point about that consensus is a focus on exports. And the best way to portray that, and Charles has just talked about China, Germany with a population of 80 million people, and remember, 20 of those 80 million people only recently joined the team from the backward East Germany, GDR, an economy of 80 million people competes year in and year out with China to be the world's largest exporter. Germany is an export machine. Secondly, unlike the United States and some other European countries, most notably Britain, Germany continues to focus on its manufacturing prowess. It is it's still, both in terms of large companies and middle-sized companies, the so-called Mittelstand, it produces stuff and sells it. And it's interesting how they've survived and been competitive in an era when new manufacturers have come from the fore to the fore from emerging markets, is they focused on a very important niche, which I would call the high value added manufacturing niche. So if you want to buy a machine tool and you want it to be the best machine tool, the most reliable machine tool, and yes, it's probably the most expensive machine tool, you typically are going to buy a German product. And that's what the Germans have carved out, and that they've had tremendous success selling their manufacturing product, whether it's machine tools, whether it's ships, whether it's cars, to a growing market, not just the United States, its European partners, Japan, but increasingly the emerging markets. They have had tremendous success selling those high value-added manufactured products into an increasingly globalized economy. That is the key to the success of the German model. They have done that by maintaining excellent infrastructure. Their logistics systems, their transport systems, their railroad systems, their airports are at the cutting edge, and they have an interesting mix between, as I was saying before, large names like in electronics and IT, Siemens, in financial services, Allianz and Deutsche Bank. And with the Mittelstand, the medium-sized companies who play a very important role in terms of a backbone for the German economy. What's the downside? The downside is there are no German Bill Gates. Germany is not a startup kind of place. In fact, there are regulations in Germany that even forbid you from starting a business in your own garage. But as the Germans like to say, if Bill Gates had been born a German, he'd be a middle-level employee with Siemens. But hey, their ability to carve out their role within the global economy has been enormously successful. Now, the role of government. One of the most interesting things that the Germans inherited from the Anglo-American occupation of Germany in the late 40s and early 50s was a decentralized federal state. The Allies worried about the concentration of power in Berlin and the centralization gave Germany a federal system, which has been a great boon to the creation of a diversified economy with centers of excellence. So if you're in Bavaria, in Munich, tends to be more of the high-tech center. If you're in Hamburg, that tends to be a media center. The center for chemicals, some of the traditional industries, is Dusseldorf. Frankfurt is a financial center. So the decentralization of Germany has served them well. And so, too, has the creation of a very good secondary school system. The Germans complain all the time about their universities, which they believe are not up to par with U.S. universities, and I think by and large they're correct. There is no German Ivy League. But at the same time, their secondary schools, in my judgment, and I think of most observers, are vastly superior to ours. So they are able to educate a large proportion of their population that can perform in the workplace. And unlike the United States, they still have preserved a kind of apprenticeship programs, which mean that their workers are in fact truly skilled workers. They're able to produce these highly value added manufacturing equipment that the Germans need to succeed in the marketplace. Part of that approach to education is a tracked educational system. You have the students at a certain age, those who are bound to go on to university are going to go to a gymnasium, they're going to go to a school where they'll be prepared for college. Those students that are going to be more and move into the blue-collar world are going to be given an education that prepares them for that as well. Just a word about government-business relations. There is not the kind of lobbying that occurs companies engage in here, where people go see members of the Bundestag or members of the government from different companies. Germany is very well organized, for the most part, into different industrial trade organizations, associations that have more formal ties into government. They provide information. They are, of course, given a campaign funding in Germany. Nobody can make political contributions to candidates. So you don't have the kind of ability to kind of corrupt the system to the degree that you have in this country. At the same time, some of the large companies and large financial institutions do enjoy very good access to the top. And it's not uncommon for the Chancellor of Germany to have dinner with the CEO of the speaker, as he's called, of the Deutsche Bank, or the CEO of Siemens or Allianz. But this is part of, I think, an informal system of making sure that the government and business stay on the same wavelength. Finally, a word about this point I made earlier about social cohesion. It is very, very important. Politically, you don't and haven't had the kind of political polarization and paralysis that you can see in Washington today. In part, that's because the Germans, because of their own special history, don't trust a single party to come to power. And so nearly every government, post-war government, German government, has been a coalition. And typically, the minor partner in that coalition has been the Liberal Party, the FDP. They're kind of centrist, pro-free enterprise party, and they tended to swing back and forth between the Christian Democrats and the Social Democrats. More recently, now, of course, you have new parties, the Greens, the Linke, but it is the kind of coalition element of German politics that keeps radicalism and polarization out of German politics. So that, and again, this sort of emphasis on income distribution and not letting incomes get widely out of whack. So looking forward, what are the potential problems with this system that seems to be working remarkably well right now? Well, one, like most European countries, you have the problem of the demographics and an aging population. And one of the solutions, obviously, to that problem is immigration. And Germany is not an immigration country. It is not a country that has a tradition of welcoming immigrants. Of course, millions of Turkish guest workers came to Germany in the 1960s and 70s, and they make up today still an important fraction of the German population. But the Germans have not done a particularly good job of integrating that group. In fact, Berlin is said to be the third largest Turkish city in the world. But the Germans will have to attract more immigrants, and that could very well lead to frictions and other problems. The bottom line about Germany is it is not a dynamic society. It is not a society that is built for high economic growth and high risk. It is a steady, stable performer. And in time of economic crisis and uncertainty, it is perfectly positioned for success.
Thank you. Andrew?
Thanks, Bill. Well, What a contrast Russia is to Germany. Russia is not a steady performer. Although, like Germany, Russia does not have Bill Gates. They have Vladimir Putin, who may well be more wealthy than Bill Gates, or anybody else in the world, for that matter. But I choose not to research that issue in much depth.
That's wise.
You know, it's great talking about Russia. Because one of my favorite comments was by Will Rogers back in the 1930s. He said, "Russia's the only country that, no matter what you say about it, it's true." And that's certainly the case when it comes to talking about the Russian economy. One can come to wildly divergent conclusions. But let me give it a go. Now, like Rick, I kind of thought this was good. Was a brick conference. So I didn't read the invitation closely enough to realize it was a meeting, whatever the acronym is. But Jim O'Neill of Goldman Sachs is a popular guy in Russia because the original BRIC report that came out 7-8 years ago really was one of the most positive, was maybe the only positive assessment of Russia done at the time. And Russia was very happy to be included in this category of rapidly growing emerging economies. Now, particularly in the wake of the financial crisis and some of the difficulties that Russia has endured, a number of people have suggested that maybe we should take the R out of BRICS and make it BIC. Now, because I'm the last speaker and you've been sitting there for a long time, I'd like to do something interactive to start out with. So I'm going to ask you a question. And the question is, you know, which of the BRIC economies do you think has seen the greatest GDP growth in dollar terms over the last decade? Okay? I'll name the country, and then you can raise your hand. I've never done this before, but I'm kind of curious to see what the how you come out on this. Okay, how many people think that China saw the greatest GDP growth in the last decade? Raise your hand, please. Okay, 3, 5, 9, 12. Okay, that's up about 20 plus or so. India, 1. Okay. Brazil, none. Russia, okay, about 10. Well, let's go to the answer, please.
I'm gonna get the answer. There we are.
Okay, the answer is Russia, and it's by a long shot. This should be a color graph, and this is from my friend and colleague Cliff Gaddy at the Brookings Institution, who I regularly steal his graphic materials. he knows it though. He says I can actually explain his graphs better than he can. But Russia's there is the first one. And you look at that dramatic growth. Now it took a big hit in the financial crisis 2008 to 2009, but nevertheless, its performance has been dramatically greater, better than in dollar terms than the other three BRICS. What's been driving it? Initially, part of it was the devaluation of the ruble post 98 financial crisis. The results of restructuring that took place in response to reforms in the 1990s, early 2000s played a big role. And certainly, the rise of the oil price played a big role. Let's go to the next. There we go. This is my favorite graphic. It's also Cliff's. Now, if I had one graphic to show about Russia, this would be the one. Okay, so this is line shows is the amount of revenue from oil and gas sales estimated coming into the Russian economy going back to 1970. As you can see, things were good in the beginning of the Brezhnev period. You had the first oil crisis, the second oil crisis, They kind of peaked around 1979, 80, 81. Things weren't so good during the Gorby-Yeltsin times. And Vladimir the Lucky, you can see what happened while he was president. And I think the best estimate of to what extent this increase in revenues contributes to growth in Russia is estimated somewhere between a third and one half of growth. But this high low oil price, high low revenue intake also it corresponds very closely with high oil price, less incentive for structural economic reform, as was the case in the Brezhnev period, and has been in the case in particularly the second Putin administration, less political openness, pluralism, and a more aggressive Russian-Soviet foreign policy. I mean, just coincidentally, the two peaks of those periods around 1980 and 2008 almost fairly closely correspond with the two times that Russian military forces have been used abroad in the last 30 plus years in Afghanistan and Georgia. But this gives you an idea. This graph also, tracks very closely economic growth and fall, et cetera. Now, still, oil and gas is going to be the biggest determinant of Russian economic performance. And what is that likely to look at by, according to the most authoritative estimates of oil price? Whoops, what happened there? Travis, I need some help. There we go. Thank you. I'll just say next, please, okay? Thank you. All right. This is the similar graphic that I showed you before, but then at a $50 oil price, $130 oil price, $200 oil price, sort of the different scenarios from the IEA for oil price out to 2030, you can see the impact of the revenue that would be coming into Russia as a result. Even at the relatively low $50 oil price, Russia is not going to do all that badly. And if you get into higher oil price scenarios, then you're going to see actually considerably more robust economic performance. Now, there's a lot more to the story than that, but that's a big piece. So let's skip these. Skip. Okay. Now, the problem for the Russians, of course, is Russia's unique in many ways. Russia is the largest economy in the world, which is so dependent upon this one factor, and which contributes to the great volatility of Russian economic performance. And not only, let's not forget that Russia went bankrupt twice in the 1990s, 1991 and 1998. And even then they experienced this extraordinary period of economic growth, where in real dollar terms, the economy was growing at about 25, 26, 27% a year, in real dollar terms, because that takes into account economic growth plus currency appreciation. That's how you get those big numbers. And they were feeling on top of the world in July of 2008 when oil price hit its all-time high of $145, $147 a barrel. And they were talking about, they were looking with a lot of schadenfreude at the United States, and the subprime mortgage crisis was starting to have a larger impact on the American economy. Oh, those poor Americans, ha, ha, ha. But we Russians, we think we are an island of stability. We are a safe haven. They were talking about this. Well, they got a rude awakening with the impact of the global economic crisis, and it was pretty much starting with the bankruptcy of Lehman Brothers in mid-September. And if we look at the, this graph shows the performance of the G20 economies, and Russia was the worst, the relatively the worst performer of all the G20 economies, in that they experienced the greatest change in from growth to increase to decrease in their economy, about a 15% change in 1 year. And that's what puts them in that, that bottom right-hand corner. And again, it, you know, re-emphasize for them something they already realized, the dangers of over-reliance on natural commodity and especially energy exports. And they had, even before the economic crisis hit, they had, while Putin was still president, they'd put together their economic goals to the year 2020, and they drew up three scenarios. And one scenario was the least optimistic scenario, and it was about 3% growth per year. And there was a mid-level scenario at about 5%, then the so-called innovation scenario, which called for about 7% growth per year, which is what the Russian economy was experiencing for the previous decade, if you take out the currency appreciation. And it was what they called the innovation scenario, and it was premised on greater diversification of the Russian economy that tried to insulate itself from the vicissitudes of the energy price. Sounds like a pretty reasonable way to go. And when Mr. Medvedev became president, this was then described as modernization, and that was has been the theme of the Medvedev presidency, the modernization of Russia and the Russian economy. Now, it's kind of interesting. I don't think there is any actual formal definition of the term modernization. I've spent a fair amount of time in Russia the last year and heard a lot of different definitions of how they understand modernization. And, you know, a lot of people will equate modernization with diversification. Well, I think that's kind of problematic. You know, the Soviet economy actually was a lot more diverse, less dependent, relatively speaking, on natural resource exports, although it was still very dependent upon them. But they did produce a lot of consumer goods. They were crappy. It was a command economy. And the command economy was more diverse, but it was a tremendous misallocation of resources because they weren't being done according to market signals. And the Russians recognized this. And if you even in the innovation scenario under their own terms, the optimal level of change in what high technology and so-called innovative sectors would constitute a driver of economic growth in the future is fairly modest. Certainly less than 10%. So I emphasize that because there's so much discussion at a fairly superficial level that really kind of tends to equate, at least in the Russian context, modernization with diversification. And the one thing I want you to take away with from this is that the amount of diversification that would make sense from the standpoint of using your comparative advantage and responding to market signals, you know, in the near to medium term, I'd say up to 2020 and 2030, is modest. Let's not overestimate that. Now, the Russians, President Medvedev, probably doesn't do himself a favor, actually, by overselling this, because he'll often speak about, you know, the primitiveness of reliance upon natural resource exports, and that's a bad thing. Well, there could be worse things, I suppose, in Russia's case, if you didn't have the natural resources. Now, the counterargument, of course, is the resource curse being, well, if they didn't have the natural resources, then the Russians would have developed other means to drive economic growth. That's true to an extent. Now, let me talk a little bit more specifically. Let's skip, if we could, to the slides on the high technology sectors and look a little more closely at what the Russians are focusing on in this modernization, so-called innovation economy framework. First, and this is based upon a chapter in an excellent book, which I coincidentally co-wrote or co-edited with Anders Osland and Sergei Guriev, Anders Osland of the Peterson Institute and Sergei Guriev, the rector of the New Economic School in Russia, called Russia After the Global Economic Crisis. And I will immodestly say it's a great book, but more modestly, it's a great book because I wrote very little of it. But it's a very good collection of various pieces that capture, I think, the political, economic, social dynamics of what's going on in Russia with a lot of empirical data to back it up. And what this is based upon is the analysis done by a couple of economists at the RAND Corporation, Keith Crane and Arthur Usanov. So the five high-tech areas the Russians have identified are software, nanotech, civilian nuclear industry, aerospace, and armaments, defense. Most of the Soviet Union's major achievements in civilian technologies were tied to its military program. Well, in essence, the Soviet Union almost, it was a military-industrial complex, full stop. The 1990s, the domestic procurement for those military goods fell tremendously by about 80% totally. In the period of high growth, 1998 to 2008, the high-tech industry played a relatively small growth in driving the increase in Russian GDP. Now, things that did drive the increase, in addition to the increase in the revenue coming in from the oil price, include retail, wholesale trade, construction, transportation, telecommunications, and Russia's recovery in the first decade of the transition. But the industrial base is still very, very, it's very old, it's very obsolete. And a lot of it goes back to the first industrialization under Stalin back in the 1930s. Okay, let's look a little bit more closely about these five sectors. Next, please. Software and information technologies. There's been considerable success in this sector. So in 1999, McKinsey estimated that this highest labor productivity in the Russian economy was in this sector at about 38%, but 38% of the U.S. level, which is about twice the average Russian level. But the gross revenues, even just 2 years ago, are quite modest, about $5.5 billion. The IT sector has been one of the most open industries in Russia. It has higher wages in IT than China or India. So it's not going to be, I think, a leader in offshore IT business. It's, but it is expanding its presence in the offshore development market and in packaging software. Development of their sector is going to depend on making the country's business environment friendlier. Now, this business-friendly environment, in many measurements of this, of course, the Russians do very poorly. Things like Transparency International, the World Economic, the Davos competitiveness, et cetera, and that's the story we know well about the very weak legal system and the problems of corruption. And this is a sector that really suffers from that quite a bit. But it has some strengths. Nanotechnology, quickly. The Russians identified nanotechnology a few years ago as a high priority, and they created this state-owned corporation, Rosnano, and they actually put at the head of it one of the most competent administrators and managers in Russia, in Anatoly Chubais, and it was fairly well capitalized with about $5 billion. Subsequently, it was drawn back a little bit with the impact on the Russian budget of the economic crisis, but still, their investments in nanotech have exceeded $1 billion, falling behind only the United States and Japan. But their innovation activity has been relatively modest. It's probably too early to tell, but just if you look at one measurement, Russia ranks 16th in the number of patents related to nanotechnology. The expectations in the near term that Crane and Usanov have for nanotech are fairly modest, and a lot of it's going to be in the area of scientific machinery, things like microscopes and such. Next, please. A more significant industry for Russia certainly is the civilian nuclear industry. Several years ago, the Russians occupy about 16-17% of the global civilian nuclear market. They aspire in the next 10 years or so to get about 25% of the global market. And nuclear industry does constitute domestically about 16-17% of power generation within Russia, and they have the same goal that the nuclear industry will occupy about 25% of Russian power generation domestically, free up more domestically produced gas for export sales. Their big advantage here is that they are the largest they have the largest capacity for uranium enrichment. They have the lowest costs of enrichment in the world, making it one of the most competitive industries in the world market. They also have some considerable assets in pieces of advanced reactor technologies. Aerospace. Rockets, satellites, civilian aircrafts. Still a leader in launchers. Proton rocket will be remain the only well-tested rocket capable of ferrying people and heavy payloads into space for the foreseeable future. Since the 1990s, the space program has depended upon commercial launch contracts and collaborative activities with other countries and foreign companies for survival. The Russian government has tried to consolidate the civilian aircraft industry. They've created this big holding company, United Aircraft Corporation, with major transport aircraft design bureaus and production facilities all being merged into the company. The story here on the future of Russian civilian aircraft, as opposed to military aircraft, is that they're really going to need to partner with Western companies, and this is the story with the MS-21. It's the story of the other major commercial aircraft projects that the Russians have underway, and it's a reflective of, I think, the role that the extent that Russian production and manufacturers are going to play a significant role in high tech innovation industries. A lot of it's going to have to be in partnership with other players. And the Russians thinking of themselves, especially IT, for example, also here, as where are they going to fit in global value chains? Armaments, of course, this was a huge relative strength of the Soviet economy. Still, the Russians are a large exporter of arms, the second largest in the world to the United States, but there's been tremendous erosion to the R&D capacity of the Russian military sector, aging of the work sector. The sector has been able to survive essentially especially in the 1990s, to what extent that it has. Because of exports, because domestic procurement almost fell down to nothing, or close to nothing. Here it's kind of ironic because we think of Soviet legacy of these huge companies, huge industrial enterprises. Well, a problem actually for the Russian defense sector is that relatively, their companies are small and they have fairly low valuations. And so again, I think looking at future development, it's going to be increasingly in concert with other foreign producers. The next, please. And that's, I think, the larger story. The Russian leaders perceive growth in high technology industries as key to defining Russia's future place in the world economy, but The Russian policy to encourage growth in high tech to this point has not been that effective. And a reason for that is that Russian policymakers have attempted to foster high-tech industries, in many cases, by consolidating existing manufacturers into large state-controlled agglomerates, especially in armaments, nuclear industry, and aerospace. Even if still in the armaments, they're relatively small by international standards, looking at European defense companies and American defense companies. And this has been what Mr. Putin started doing in 2006, 2000, 2007. And this has been a fairly noticeable piece of so-called industrial planning. I can only say that I would agree with Charles how he was characterizing industrial planning in the Chinese case, Putin, the rationale for the Russians to do this is that, well, we need to have national champions so they can compete internationally with other large international companies. There's not much evidence to support that is a policy that will be effective, and the more I think that Russian government will help its entrepreneurs think about where they actually fit in global value chains, is going to be the way to go. But still, the bottom line is that if you look at 2008, industrial output, or the high-tech sector of industrial output was about 9.8%. Industrial output, all told, was about 30% of Russia's GDP. So therefore, the high-tech sector, currently is contributing about 3 to 4% of Russian GDP, fairly marginal. Not insignificant, but fairly marginal. This is not going to be the big driver of growth for the Russian economy in the future. And just one last word, because I found this kind of an interesting study, because most of the studies that look at Russian competitiveness, business environment, et cetera, put Russia in very, very, very unsavory territory with Zambia and 180 countries, Russia ranks 145 or something like that. Well, I came across this recent Deloitte Global Manufacturing Competitiveness Index, and I do not vouch for the methodology behind here, but I just found the results interesting. The survey was done by global CEOs. As to which countries have the most manufacturing competitiveness, and today and will in the future, and these are the criteria ranked from most significant to least significant, the 10 most important criteria they see when they rank global competitiveness, and you can see it's not surprisingly a much wider set of criteria than simply looking at the legal environment. And the issue of corruption, where obviously Russia doesn't do very well. Number three, energy cost and policies. Well, Russia does better there because of the relatively low domestic energy costs. Number one, talent-driven innovation. Russians do relatively well there. Number two, cost of labor and materials, not so much. That's a big comparative advantage of China, et cetera. Let's go to the last one, and then I'll shut up, because this is where it came out. Currently, Russia came in 20th place, ahead of Italy, South Africa, France, Belgium, Argentina, and Saudi Arabia. But of more interest was their expectations for the future, and that Russia in 5 years would be the biggest mover of all of these countries. We go to the next slide, please. And that Russia would move from 20th to 14th place. So here we go, a significant report like the BRIC report 7-8 years ago, with a rather optimistic sense of Russia's future. So on that optimistic note, let me conclude. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's go to our talented pool of participants out here. Questions, please. Go ahead. Here's the mic coming.
Thank you. This is about China, and the question is addressed to Mr. Freeman. I was struck in your talk, if I understand it correctly, about this model of China model, whatever that model may be, is not as successful as people may think. I think that's what you're saying. You gave the example of the state-run companies, for example, not being very profitable. On the other hand, I think it's my view that China's rise is much broader than just that. Obviously, it's been able to turn around a communist nation into a market-oriented type of nation in a very short period of time, manages borders, its geostrategic relationships with its neighbors and the world. Its presence in Africa, that's a huge, typically a domain of Europe and the U.S., and is achieved a kind of growth, 10% a year for 31 years, at a scale and a speed that has never been seen for a nation ever in the history of mankind, if I'm correct. So I would see that as some kind of success, if nothing, and perhaps in looking at and of course it's the largest country in the world, 5,000 year history that dwarfs Europe. So to look at a model for China, perhaps, if there is such a thing, would have to be a much broader view of it from that kind of historic perspective. I was wondering if you want to comment on that.
I don't disagree with that. The Chinese economy is extraordinarily successful. But I think the panel is really about the industrial policies and whether those are successful. And I think in Chinese industrial policy making, Chinese economic policy for years and years and years has been predominated by focus on market reform. Again, the kind of getting out of the way and deregulation and removing barriers to trade and commerce, removing the barriers not just to international commerce but to intra-provincial interprovincial commerce that are enormously successful, building roads and rails and processes to move goods and services throughout the Chinese economy. That's been tremendous success. What I'm suggesting is that any industrial policies, if the Chinese policymakers sitting in Beijing believe that the next wave of growth or that China's future economic growth depends on the kind of narrow state-driven capitalism, the kind of growth that's reliant on further empowering, further shoring up these national champion state-owned enterprises, which is fundamentally what seems to have been the conclusion drawn by the majority of Chinese policymakers today, I would be very cautious about China's future success if they really go down that road. My own feeling, because I do believe that if there is a country and a group of people which is more pragmatic than the Chinese, I don't know which ones they are, that they will recognize the foolishness of the kind of industrial policy making path on which they're now trotting and will chuck the people that are responsible for it in due course. But right now, if you have to say what will happen as a result of these policies, if they're generally shored up, I think that there will be a stumble, and there will be some people whose heads will roll as a result. But I certainly wouldn't argue for a moment that China's economic success has been extraordinary. I think it is. It is certainly of our age the story. And if one wants to talk about a Chinese model which is in large part deregulation, focus on market reform to drive growth with some sort of wise spending to try to increase the competitiveness of the Chinese economy, that I think I'd have to argue is a tremendous model. Okay. But drawing other inferences and other lessons from the results of the crises, which suggest that the market is not the way to go, I think would be dangerous and is dangerous.
There was a question right here, please.
No, it's okay. Thank you. I'm Keiichiro Nakazawa from Japan International Cooperation Agency, or JICA. I'm working in the field of international development and very interested in some lessons drawn from experiences in some successful countries like Brazil, China, and Russia maybe, and not maybe Germany. But in many developing countries try to apply industrial policies, but in many cases they failed. And they failed not because they you know, using the industry policies in a, you know, mistaken way, but rather they failed because they chose or selected industries, I mean, the, which would be losing. I mean, not the picking the winners, but picking the losers. And sometimes it's too ambitious or too too advanced, depend, you know, compared with the level of development or the endowment structure of those countries. And I wonder, in the case of Brazil, or maybe in China or Russia, how, you know, what kind of criteria those governments used to select the industries to be protected or supported or to be developed? And I'd like to know the lessons which we can utilize to other also, you know, other developing countries. Thank you.
Kelly?
In the case of Brazil, I mean, if you look at the sectors that have been identified, in most cases, there's sectors where there really is a national need for more, for lack of a better term, supply. So you're looking at infrastructure, you're looking at energy, you're looking at healthcare. And, you know, truly in those three sectors at least, I would say that the way that Brazil interprets their national interest is very much that you must have, you know, in the same way that some countries may look at having, you know, homegrown food supplies or a homegrown defense industry, viewing that as being in your national interest. I would say that in those three sectors, Brazil views those equally as such. I think that where the challenge may end up coming is that, I mean, the bottom line is, you know, Brazil's prospects going forward, just given the growth dynamics globally, the demand in China and elsewhere in Asia and globally, et cetera, is positive enough that I would say that most companies, be them foreign companies or Brazilian companies, are looking at really investing more and growing their operations in Brazil, no matter what the industrial policy is. So I guess a concern or fear that I would have going forward is that if you, as a government, overthink that a little bit too much and try to overly encourage by forcing localization policies, by imposing binational policies, et cetera, in an era where all companies, no matter where they're based, you know, by definition, unless you're talking some of these overly programmatic situations in China, et cetera, have global supply chains, I think that inherently you're limiting the either the extent to which companies can continue to grow and or the level to which, you know, you're going to reach technologically with those investments. Because if you can't tap into those global supply chains, at a certain point it is going to limit your ability to go forward. But in Brazil, I would say that, you know, the definition of sectors, getting to your question, very much came out of, you know, necessity for the market.
If I hear
domestic market, not exports, to start.
I remember one of the statistics you had, Kelly, was that Brazil's trade is 30% of the GDP in Brazil, whereas 65% in China. And what I think I hear you saying is that Brazil's so-called industrial policy is focused on domestic rather than export growth.
I think so far, yes. I mean, it's interesting. I mean, you'll find that in Brazil, first of all, just, you know, informally surveying companies that are doing business in Brazil right now. For example, on this new binational policy, there was a very low level of concern about that policy writ large, primarily because what you'll hear just anecdotally from most companies is, look, we're going to continue to invest in our operations and our manufacturing capacity just to keep up with Brazilian needs and Brazilian growth. So at least, I mean, looking at it from a short-term perspective, that's how the companies are looking at it. It certainly is how the government is looking at it. And that 30% is actually a huge increase from mm-hmm. when I originally started working on Brazil. That number was like 10, yeah. You know, when I first moved there at the time the Plano Real first came in. So mm-hmm. even that is a huge advance. But you'll find that even these, you know, Brazilian multinationals, the Multibrasis, even in Brazil, have come under criticism to some extent when they have made major investments overseas, major operations in China or Russia or Africa. There's been something of a domestic backlash or reaction to that, saying, well, hey, you're a Brazilian company. You need to be creating jobs in Brazil. Does that sound familiar to us Americans? Yes, it does. But you know, so you'll see a large American company or large, excuse me, Brazilian companies taking out full-page ads in the Brazilian newspapers saying, you know, we employ Brazilians. It's something that's, you know, I guess a bit unusual and does, Bill, to your point, kind of reinforce the idea that the domestic market is still not the only focus, but a big focus.
Rick, the last question we had on this agenda was, how is the policy-making environment responding to successes and failures? I'd like to ask more, how's it responding to the perceived risk? Germany, in this particular conversation, is unusually dependent upon exports to China. And Germany also faces the challenge of dealing with the problems in Europe. I'm not sure that I get a sense of the degree of flexibility they have in responding to the threat of a Chinese bubble burst, for example, or a similar action in Portugal or Spain.
Well, that's a very good question. And in fact, they early on in the financial crisis, they did face a very substantial drop-off in exports. What is interesting was how quickly they adapted and diversified their whole approach to exports. I mean, China, correctly, is a very important growth market for them, but they don't rely simply on China. I mean, as Andy knows, they have become the Russian Federation's number one economic partner. They are the largest exporter to Russia. They are now, they've discovered India, and their business leaders are all over India as well as Latin America. One thing I should have said is, while in my view, and I'll speak very candidly here, while German politicians are not a very impressive lot, sort of similar to ours, I think they probably have the highest quality managerial class in the world. It's hard to meet a German CEO who doesn't have a PhD, who doesn't have a great grasp of history, who can't discuss classical music and art. They are very well-educated strategic thinkers, and they are internationalists. And they understand, in a way similar to, say, a Dutch business manager, because they need to export as well, or a Finn. They rely on being able to penetrate foreign markets, and thus, I think, are very successful at it. Now, the euro crisis really poses some very serious challenges. And I think, but their approach to that crisis in the short term is to recognize that with lower growth likely in the rest of Euroland, they're going to have to export beyond Euroland. So I don't think they can make the same assumptions they're going to be able to sell, for example, as many BMWs or Mercedes in Spain or Portugal as they did before. But of course, the big markets are not in Spain and Portugal. So unless there is a fundamental collapse in world trade, I think the Germans will do just fine. The really more interesting question is what are they going to do about the euro? Because for the first time in recent memory, their requirement to stand up and engage in these bailouts. Greece, Ireland, mm-hmm. Portugal, potentially Portugal and others, has really led to a domestic backlash at home. And you can imagine it if you saw that in American terms. What if we were suddenly bailing out because of the Mexicans or the Canadians or NAFTA? I mean, and this is
might become, be closer to home, might be California.
Yeah.
Don't bail us out.
But these are massively unpopular. And if, in fact, the price is going to be continuing bailouts coupled with the potential for stimulus policies and the unwillingness of their European partners to accept fiscal restraint, you could very well have, I think, a decision taken by the German establishment, say, in the next 18 months to 2 years, to return to the Deutschmark. That is the core. A sound currency is the core not only of German economic policy, but their sort of political identity.
That's perfect. We're drawing to the conclusion. So one quick last question with the highest hand back there.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon. My name is Allison Johnson, and I thought the panel was very fascinating. I'm building a smart power initiative at Northrop Grumman Corporation, sort of looking at how U.S. foreign policy is affecting some of these amazing changes around the world. And I'm really interested, as the discussions are going on in Cancun by the United Nations, how these BRICS, or including Germany, have really attacked their industrial policy as it relates to our climate, to our environment. Having worked in all of these countries, I have been very struck by how the Germans were very, you know, aware that their industrial policy could not ruin the environment that they lived in. And you find that when they work around the world, whereas the rest of the BRICS cannot say as strongly an acknowledgement that, you know, pollution and environmental degradation are some of the consequences of their industrial policy. So if the panelists could comment on that, and also how the developing world can either use these models or not, because they have to consider this as they grow as well and how it affects our planet. Thank you.
Since it's such a simple question, can I ask you all to give it at least a minute?
Let me just say a word about Germany, because this is fundamentally different than either the BRIC countries or the United States, for that matter. I mean, there has been an organized environmentalist mentality and movement in Germany for 30 years. I mean, they have probably the most successful Green Party in the world. In fact, the Green Party today is now, according to the latest poll in Spiegel, is larger than the Social Democrats. So it's the second largest party in Germany. And it just gives you some sense of their popularity. The Germans have, as you know, shut down all their nuclear reactors. So they have no nuclear reactors, in great distinction to their neighbors in France. They have become in part so closely tied to the Russian economy because they are such large importers of Russian natural gas because of their environmental movement, and there is just a political consensus from left to right that conservation, environmentalism is next to godliness, if not in an increasingly German secular culture, ahead of godliness. The amazing thing is it's clear that they have paid a major economic price to do this. And when you think about the costs which they subsidize things like biodiesel and wind energy, and solar energy. I mean, it rains most of the time in Germany, but they say, yeah, that they, when you add that to the cost of integrating the German Democratic Republic, the East Germany, and the fact that they have been able to absorb those two big price tags and still come out as one of the best performing economies in the world, you sort of understand how Germany almost won World War II, fighting Britain, the United States, and the Soviet Union collectively. I mean, they are a highly talented, motivated, and disciplined people.
Just a quick point on Brazil. I mean, I think Brazil's case is a little bit unique because their energy grid is just naturally so green. If you go back 9 years ago when you had the energy crisis in Brazil due to the droughts, the reason was because about 80% of their energy was coming off of hydro. They moved to more diversification after that point because they realized it was such a vulnerability. And their challenge has been really, particularly since they've made these massive pre-salt finds, which, you know, getting them out of the ground is going to be a lot harder than finding them. But a major debate that they're having within the country now is, you know, how can they continue to diversify their energy grid so that it remains quite dependent on hydro, but does take in some of these other, you know, wind energy, et cetera. They did the first wind bid last year since they developed their ProInfa, their wind program, about 5 years ago. They finally, you know, are kind of getting off the dime and moving forward on these things. So I think that you'll see a continuing focus on ensuring, and obviously in Brazil in the 70s during the oil crisis, they developed their now famous, you know, ethanol program. So they are very heavily dependent upon bioethanol and biodiesel from sugarcane. So you'll continue to see that being a very important part of Brazilian development going forward is maintaining a green energy grid and further diversifying it. Where Brazil historically has been looked at with, you know, more of a critical eye has been in agriculture, right? And you know, that's something where I think both because of a strong recognition in the Brazilian public, the government, NGOs have become more involved in Brazil as well, much to the Brazilian government's frustration at times, I think, but that is an issue that is being looked at as far as deforestation of the Amazon biome a lot more carefully and a lot more strategically.
Andy?
Thanks. Great question. There's been some interesting movement on that in the last couple of years in Russia. You know, during the Putin presidency, the Russians were not particularly enthusiastic about the Kyoto Protocol. His chief economic advisor, Andrei Ilyanov, was an avid opponent of the Kyoto Protocol, going through copious calculations that this would be a hindrance on economic growth in the longer term for Russia. The Russians did accede to the protocol, essentially, but it was a transactional agreement for the European Union to support their WTO accession if the Russians did that. Now, what's happened in the last couple of years is interesting, and this is, I think, part of the wake-up call of the global economic crisis has had for the Russian leadership. You know, Russia is one of the most energy inefficient countries in the world, and the potential savings that they can have for their economy and in becoming more energy efficient, and the numbers are quite staggering. That's had an impact on them, and also driven by as a major energy producer. This will, if you use less domestically, then you can export more. And it was a major World Bank study that came out in December of 2008, and I think this has been pushing the Medvedev government to be a little more proactive on this.
It's a great question. I mean, and it gives me the opportunity to say that CSIS has recently published a piece called Green Dragons, which actually looked at Asian approaches to climate change and from both a domestic politics and industrial policy approach. So look for that at csis.org. But the China, you know, is obviously an autocracy and so has less perhaps of a direct concern for, I mean, there is no Green Party in China, and there is unlikely to be for some time. But you won't go broke looking at Chinese policy through a prism that assumes a fundamental concern by the Chinese Communist Party for their political future and for their role as the, quote, legitimate governing entity in China. So most Chinese policies are taken with a view to how do they manage, how do they preserve their own primacy, and climate change policy is certainly part and parcel of that exercise. fundamentally, the Chinese government has done a back-of-the-envelope calculation that they need 8% annual growth in order to provide 50,000 GDP growth, in order to provide 50,000 new jobs a day, and that 50,000 new jobs a day reduces the chances of political instability that will result in their having to deal with local unrest. So any challenge to 8% annual GDP growth is going to be a source of political concern. Certainly worrying about putting in place hard caps or commitments on climate change is something the Chinese government is going to be assiduously opposed to, and is going to make every effort in global discussions to reduce. That said, there is a certain amount of sincerity, actually a fair amount of sincerity, about reducing environmental degradation in China, because it's a political problem, because there are increasing protests and about health-related concerns related to environment. So there is an effort to try to reduce the environmental degradation, and it's sincere. It's just that they don't want anybody from the outside reducing their flexibility in growth. The last piece of this puzzle is, you know, like a lot of countries, China is trying to promote a domestic green technology industry, in part because there is a widespread belief in China that that Kyoto and the sort of green technology movement around the world is a plot by the West to try to keep China down for the next wave of industrial growth. So there is a strong industrial policy political attempt to promote green technology in China to the deterrence of other countries' abilities to produce that by using the scale of the Chinese economy to promote these kinds of products. Does that mean we have a green technology war in the future? It's certainly possible. I think at a minimum you've got a little bit of a green technology bubble going on in China and arguably elsewhere. Is that a terrible thing? No, because it just promotes more and more green technologies that eventually will be valuable, but it means a lot of people will go broke in the process of trying to capitalize on the green technology wave. I'll have to say that.
I'm going to wrap it up. Excuse me. Thank you very much. With the one or two thoughts. First of all, I love the last question. I just got back last month from Shanghai, where I spoke to an expo conference on green cities. And my sense is that there's a substantial increase in interest in China, in part because it's an economic growth opportunity. And maybe in terms of exports, their clean coal technology is arguably better than ours. And they're making enormous progress in a number of other areas. I just finished yesterday looking at a McKinsey study on the urbanization of China, and I brought just two numbers here. In the next 15 years, they're going to have 350 million more people in their cities. They're going to have 221 cities with more than a million people. Europe has 35 today. The building that they got to do, 50,000 new high-rise buildings, 50,000, which is 10 times that of New York City. So I mean, they have got to deal with some serious problems. And that probably is the way to conclude. The thing that I have been listening to with some interest is the conundrum that politicians in all of these countries, whether they are authoritarian or they're all politicians in one way or another, except North Korea, maybe. But the Chinese government has to respond because it faces that problem of people flooding into the cities, the need to create 50,000 new jobs a month. If you look at what every country is trying to do, they're trying to solve their domestic problems with exports. Now, I think I could make the Adam Smith argument that if everybody exported the things that they did best, we probably would have global growth at an astonishing pace. The problem is when you talk about industrial policy where political judgment is imposed, then you may be competing as to who has the best right to develop this particular industrial area. And that's when we get into trouble. The worry that I have is that we've got some serious problems facing these countries. Political systems are slow to respond. And we face the question of whether or not we can respond quickly enough with industrial policies, or whether there are other ways we can gather our best judgments together and achieve a more global response that deals with the problems. We've got bubbles coming. We have the potential of not just dot-coms in the States or subprime. You've got a Chinese bubble with potential. All of these things drive us to look at the question, do we have the capacity to adjust quickly enough to keep from falling off another cliff? That's a matter for another conversation. But I want to thank the panel for some really remarkably thoughtful comments.